I want to bring in our guest right now. He's been hanging out in the green room. And there
Hikaru.
He is. Hikaru from The Human and the Machine. Welcome, welcome, man. It's great to have you on.
Hey, 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 guys. Glad welcome to finally be on the show.
Yes. Welcome to the show, man. It's been a little while. How are you doing?
Very good, very good. You know, I've always, you know, was the one watching in the club, so I never thought about being, you know, one of the guests on, so really excited.
Yeah, now you're here, man. You were just in the green room. You're behind the curtain now, you know what I mean? So it's awesome. So Hikaru, Human and the Machine and Dexalot, we've been, we've been colleagues for a while now. But I thought maybe for like our new viewers or for people that don't know The Human and the Machine, perhaps that might be in our chat, would you be able to tell us like a little bit of your background and, you know, personally and professionally and like how you got involved with Human and the Machine and what Human and the Machine is?
Yeah, absolutely. So,
great.
I mean, there's always a story, right? And how we started everything.
We love
stories. Yeah, personally, I first found about the Bitcoin in the late 2015. So got very lucky, right? And at that time, you know, just still in college at the time and learning about the tech side. And the more I read the white paper, the more I got in, I just got, you know, glued. Never looked back, went down the rabbit hole. So since then, I've been working with very close people of mine. I'm in the industry, you know, doing like advisory, working very closely. And some of them was like media marketing side as well. So it was really just about like, okay, we have this blockchain layer one, right? You know, back then, like Ethereum, all the Ethereum competitors. And then people were trying to figure out what to do with the blockchain in itself. This was way, way before DeFi or NFT. So it's very primitive at that time. So yeah, a lot of, you know, collaboration and coming up with ideas and building the basics of what we have today. So I think fast forward, we just kept doing that, going to many conferences. And it was pretty tiring, right? My partner and I were traveling, you know, every like week or so. And then it come COVID. We're like, oh, shoot, we can't do this anymore. Digital nomad, you know, is over. So we decided to kind of settle down. And then, you know, we were thinking, okay, how can we still stay connected with the co-founders, you know, teams, right? Because we still have the digital Zoom and so forth. So that's where the podcast story kind of started, where, okay, we knew a lot of people, you know, we wanted to interview them and get the world, the content out there. So yeah, our job was to really, you know, simplify a lot of these technical or, you know, really confusing Web3 concepts that most of the new people wouldn't understand. Because again, we're in a very, very small circle right now, and we want to expand it by bringing in more people in from the mainstream. So yeah, that was the idea, right? It's where, you know, my co-host and I, who was more like a simpleton, you know, the average human, and then the machine, right? A bit more technical, tries to explain so that the human can understand. So hence the human and machine. So our goal is to really just simplify all of these complex, you know, Web3 jargon out there so that people who are even watching this or, you know, maybe watching this in the future can grasp it and not be like, okay, you know, Web3 is too scary.
That's awesome.
And I want to add, The Human and the Machine is actually a very long-running show as well.
Yes.
You guys have done a lot of episodes. And guys, go check it out. You know, The Human and the Machine, Hikaru and the rest of his team has been a partner to us. And they've been doing a lot of good work in a lot of other areas, not just decentralized exchanges. So give it a follow. Give it a subscribe. Check it out.
Yes.
They have some really good content out there.
I mean, before I pass the mic to Firestorm, I have to say, like, you know, our production value here on Twitch, what we do on YouTube, you know, a lot of our stuff, we've been very influenced by the production values of the Human and the Machine channel. You know what I mean? Because you guys go all out in your editing and, you know, we take all those tenets very seriously, too. So shout out to The Human and the Machine, man. They've been doing their thing for a long time. It's just really cool to have Hikaru here. So thanks, man.
Yeah, likewise. I think it's really about inspiring others, right? And then getting that feedback so we can keep going.
Awesome. Absolutely. Thank you. That's exactly what we believe in as well. Hikaru, so, you know, you are in a unique position, right? You work across blockchains. You work across projects. So I kind of want to ask you, you know, we have a little bit of activity in the market right now, as you know, and I kind of want to ask you, what is your view of where the general market is, particularly Web3, or if you want to talk about non-Web3 markets, that's okay as well. Like, what's your view on the macro? Where do you think we're going? And when do you think, like, we'll have a regime change? When do you think we'll be out of the state that we're in currently?
Yeah, this is the question everyone wants to know. And, you know, I don't have a crystal ball, so these are just my personal opinions. I think for the most part, you know, just talking to so many people, we can agree that we've seen the worst. You know, we're past this despair stage where everyone's like, okay, you know, it's the end of the crypto, right? Blah, blah, blah. So I think people are now starting to get the idea that, okay, we're starting to make this recovery, maybe slow accumulation going sideways. If there's another crash, okay, fine, like, you know, not a surprise. But after that, okay, we're going to start our next bull run. So I think we're just about there where people are still cautious, but long term, you know, they know that the halving is coming for Bitcoin. And that's always been a sign of, you know, the next bull cycle. So I think that's kind of like where we're at. We still see a lot of projects, you know, building diligently with this in mind, going after funding. So it's a very, like, you know, tipsy, balancey, careful kind of state. And the liquidity is also very tight as well. So that's why I think a lot of the very strong founders or teams that have true innovation are still sticking around, preparing for this next bull cycle. But we're just not there yet where Bitcoin is going to go back to, you know, its all-time high tomorrow.
Yeah, we've been sort of toying with the idea of, should we do a segment for financial advice? Like, this was a sort of joke among ourselves in the team, given where the market is. And we thought, hey, the first financial advice we can give out is, guys, the market can at worst go to zero.
We should still do that.
Yeah, we totally should create that segment. But I mean,
COO would love it.
Yes, he will enjoy that tremendously. I don't know if he's watching, but jokes aside, you know, we saw tremendous downside in 2022, right? Like, you know, every valuation has come down. We know Bitcoin and Ethereum as the two major sort of assets in the ecosystem recovered some of the big losses, obviously. You know, with that said, I don't think anybody truly knows where the market is going. I think the only things that I feel I feel somewhat good about is a significant amount of the leverage in the system has exited by end of 2022, right? You know, on-chain stats probably show this better, but, you know, we had a lot of, I mean, this is typical of industry cycles, right? You have players that gain meteoric, you know, sort of trajectories, and then as either their products become obsolete or as their processes don't work that well, as some of them disappear, right? And I think you know, the one thing that surprised me, honestly, this cycle, particularly in 2022, was that my expectation, having been through a few of these cycles, was that the shock and the sort of the circular pattern should be more muted than before. And I was completely wrong. Like, that's not what happened. If anything, it was even worse because a larger amount of money was vaporized because of, you know, some of the companies that are disappearing and taking away, like, causing losses for their users. And I thought, you know, things would slowly start to converge towards a more traditional finance market move. You know, traditional financial markets do have cycles as well, but the cycle amplitudes are significantly more compressed, and crypto hasn't gotten that yet. Maybe the next regulatory changes may cause that. You know, in that vein, we talk about, you know, the regulatory changes in the US, North America particularly, a lot, because, you know, SEC is typically, you know, very vocal, and we're closely based in the US. But I know for a fact that there is a lot of regulatory updates in Middle East, and most importantly in Asia. I think our audience doesn't hear a lot about what changes are happening in Asia. I don't know how much you can say, but we would love to get an opinion on this from you, because it's all doom and gloom on the US side, but I know there's a lot of cool things that are happening in Asia, if you don't mind giving us sort of color.
Yeah, fortunately, a lot of good things are happening in Asia, right? It's very, you know, paradoxical, but I think one of the biggest things is Hong Kong. You know, they actually got the regulations down, although it's not like the most favorable, at least it's clear, right? Okay, you got to give out licenses, only this crypto. So it's a very important signal, I think, in the industry that the Asian countries are watching, because we all know that Hong Kong has been a leader, right, in finance and these kind of digital innovations. And then for them to kind of set this rule, it's really only a matter of time before these other Asian countries start following. So it's still kind of like a watch and see approach, but people know that it is going in the right direction. So in that sense, right, for example, I was at that Web3 festival in Hong Kong a few months ago. And oh my gosh, like, I felt it was like bull market again. So I go to the booths, right? And there's a bunch of, you know, copycat, you know, projects that sprung up out of nowhere. I've never heard of them before. But when this usually happens, there's a lot of like really good sentiment coming in, because people pay money for like for these booths, and it's really not cheap. So in that sense, I think, yeah, people are really getting ready in Asia for, okay, regulations coming in, it's going to be more clear. Now let's start, you know, businesses and, you know, more crypto activity.
It's funny you say that. I have a running joke between friends where we say that one of the best indicators, or actually two of the best indicators of bulls and bears, are one, conference attendance and conference projects, and two, strip club, you know, closures. If a lot of strip clubs are closing down, you know that a lot of crypto bros are disappearing, you know, together. But I don't have enough data to actually say if this is true or not. I don't know who would publish that data, but I would love to see it. But anyways, if I understood correctly, and you said this best, right? Hong Kong is really trying to push this space forward. Look, a rule-based approach to regulation is, in my opinion anyways, more favorable than an enforcement-based sort of approach. When you create enforcement actions against companies who didn't have rules to abide by so far, you're like beating them up first, then telling them what the rules are. When in reality, it should be, here are the rules, buddy. You need to comply with them. And if you don't comply is when you would expect enforcement to sort of come around. You know, it's quite a crucible in that sense in the US, in my opinion. And I think it created this amazing opportunity where, you know, jurisdictions like Hong Kong can actually come up with rules. And I know for a fact, we've had conversations with some of the officials from the Hong Kong region. They are talking to projects. They are asking for their opinion. They are asking for their input. And yeah, you can't get everything right in the first try, but at least they're making a concerted effort to make this open and available. And more importantly, I think they're trying to make Hong Kong the place to build Web3 companies, the place to provide these services, right? So, you know, we're quite excited about what's happening there, at least. And, you know, we're obviously, you know, looking to see what that brings on. Because as the regulation comes, we think we're going to get a lot more activity. We think we're going to get a lot more users. There's going to be a lot more capital coming into the space. So I think, you know, I think good things are happening. Even though everybody's focused on the price action, there's some real infrastructure. And I'm talking regulatory infrastructure being put in.
Yeah, I go to the strip club every week to see what the markets are like, man.
and how's it has been?
You know, it's creeping up, man. It's creeping up.
Maybe more people, strippers. Less people. Oh, okay. You know,
strippers are making dough.
Let's call this the Jimmy2times strip club index. You know, we're gonna start publishing the numbers based on his observations,
yes.
And we'll use that as a technical indicator that people can trade around.
The leading resource.
The leading technical indicator.
Yeah, anyways. Maybe you can overlay that on the Dexalot trading, right?
Yeah. You
the
know,
Jimmy indicator.
Yes, the Jimmy2times market indicator.
There you go.
Devs, are the devs on here? Devs?
Yes, I think I created a Jira for this already. So before I said it, but so I guess changing gears a little bit, right? Crypto has been around 10 years, right? A little bit more than 10 years if you count the initial, you know, white paper for Bitcoin as the entry point. What do you think has been built and what do you think is missing? I know there's a lot of missing, but what are the things that you would like to see happen so that this market doubles or tenfolds itself?
Yeah. Man, this is one of the most simple yet complicated topics that we talk to every single project about. Because no matter if you're gaming, DeFi, infrastructure, they all face the same problem, user experience. Because before in the bull cycle, everyone was just targeting these Web3 natives and degens. Who knows MetaMask and all these things, right? So it wasn't as much of a problem to get the users. But come now, where there's a lot less people, and people actually need more users, right, than the existing, you know, Web3 degens, it comes down to user experience. This MetaMask, a seed phrase, is just still really horrible. And people lose it all the time. So I think a lot of people are creating like hybrid Web 2.5 solutions. Okay, you log in with Google or, you know, Apple ID and then some things like that. But even then, okay, when you send and receive crypto, there's like a 0x and a bunch of numbers. And it's kind of like back in the internet days where there is no like Dexalot.com, but maybe it's like a, like a DNS, a bunch of numbers, right? Which doesn't make sense to people. So I think for crypto to become like the internet we know today, these 0x addresses need to be like, you know, Jimmy2times.eth or, you know, Firestorm.bnb, something like that. And we already do see that, but it's not still standardized as much. And I think if I sign up for a new wallet, it should be by default, you know, my username.
ENS sort of handles, if anything. Yeah. But I mean, let me ask you this. Obviously, domain names are very tricky to own and acquire, quite honestly. There are people out there that will go out and crawl all possible domain names. And what would prevent people from doing that from wallets? I know that like it's a much better solution than 0x followed by, you know, 50 decimals. But, you know, do you think the ENS domain names are going to be the solution here? Or do you actually envision, you know, wallet providers or, you know, custodians, whether they're centralized or decentralized, converging into a standard?
Yeah, it's a very good question. I don't think ENS will be the only one domain provider. I think there's going to be a lot more competitors as there are today. But the way I see it is like a much, much bigger picture, right? It's not going to be just, you know, a domain name, but it's going to be an entire identity. Okay, we have a wallet and we have all these blockchain addresses and history. Now people are playing games and there's like, you know, other third parties that are collecting data on you. So I think it's going to be like this, like real digital identity that, you know, people have been talking about for ages, but of course tracked on chain. Now, I don't know how that exactly looks. There could be biometrics in, but yeah, it's just going to be more than just a, you know, ENS name.
Absolutely. I think you're absolutely right. Like identity tied to, or I should say identity that is also your gateway to the decentralized world, whether it's applications or games or whatever, is probably the single most highest value thing that can change, right? You know, the WW whatever address versus typing the numbers made the massive difference in people being able to remember the web pages that they use, right? Okay. Identity as well as management of the wallets. Is there anything else that you think we need before we can acquire more non-Web3 users into the Web3 world?
Yeah, the other one comes on to liquidity. And in that sense, you know, we hear a lot of projects going on multi-chain, right? And I believe, you know, Dexalot has this on the road as well. Thing is, I think multi-chain came up because there was no other choice. People start with one chain. Okay, once they build traction, they go to another chain. Or, you know, maybe other chains are giving out grants, so there's incentives. But I think it's always going to be a problem with fragmentation and just so many development hurdles we have. So there will be a new generation of a middle layers that kind of encapsulates and handles all of these, you know, different chains in the background. So here's an analogy. You know, I have a U.S. credit card issued by Visa, right? I can go anywhere in the world that accepts Visa and pay in U.S. dollars. But in the back end, it's going to be paying in, you know, Hong Kong dollars or Thai baht or wherever I am. And the user doesn't really care because the bank handles that in the back end. It's going to be like that, right? I can maybe pay in USDT on Binance Smart Chain, whatever I want. And then in the back end, it's going to propagate to whatever chain it's going to be and handle all the liquidity. So capital efficiency in a way.
Absolutely agreed. And on the Dexalot side, we sort of tried to solve this by creating an exchange-specific subnet, which doesn't allow, at least for now, doesn't allow tokens to be issued on it, so that we can solve the liquidity fragmentation by giving a gateway or a deposit contract on each of the host chains and allowing them by issuing credit to them in the subnet to trade on credit with assets that we know are backed in their primary chains, right? The idea and the intention here was that, you know, Ethereum coming from one chain and Ethereum coming from another should still be somewhat tradable as long as they are actual Ethereum, and allow people to sort of trade with liquidity, even if the liquidity resides in different places, allow them to trade against each other, thereby improving capital efficiency. With that said, as we have more and more blockchains that are connected to each other in as native a way as possible, I know Layer Zero is pushing towards this. Avalanche obviously has its own solution, you know, liquidity situation will improve. The second thing I also want to mention, just to add on at the back of what you said, the biggest piece of liquidity actually that we're missing is the liquidity that sort of supports traditional finance. I know I always say traditional finance, but there's a lot of money there, right? And that money basically gets used through credit facilities that are directly integrated into the fabric of the rails, right? You want banks and credit providers to integrate into exchanges such as Dexalot, or integrate into custodians or prime brokers, if you will, and provide that credit so people can use that credit to do their trading, right? I think that is the key thing that will, because right now there is liquidity, and no matter how much of the cross-chain situation you solve, if you look at the total size of the dollars or total size of money available, it's still going to be dwarfed by what you actually could acquire through traditional financial users. Anyways, I agree. These probably are the two biggest issues that we face today before, you know, this market tenfolds or hundredfolds itself, right? Now, again, you're in a very unique position. You talk to a lot of projects. You interview a lot of guys. What types of projects are, in your opinion, most interesting nowadays, right? Like, what are the most common thing that you see? What do you think people are focusing on building nowadays, right now?
Yeah, it's a very, very good question. We still see a lot in gaming, okay? Not play to earn, but okay, you know, here's like a fun game, mobile or desktop, and it's using blockchain transaction in the background. And they're usually very like niche and focused, like a mobile first-person shooter, anime style, or something like very specific. So in that sense, I think we're maturing in that, okay, people are now learning how to actually use the blockchain, right? Besides its financial incentives. So I think that's good. The second one is when it comes to DeFi, in a good way, we're starting to see a lot of these projects that's very similar. Not meaning it's a Uniswap copy and paste, but like the innovation they're actually making, the differences are very subtle, or you have to be super technical to understand the value proposition. So it's kind of like, you know, chips, right? Before we went from like 20 nanometers to like 14 and 7, but we're kind of slowing down in terms of the pace of the innovation because it is actually getting much, much harder to innovate on DeFi itself. So I think it's a good problem to have, also maturing, but that's kind of like how we see. So when we look at DeFi projects, we really have to ask, you know, the DeFi expert and really look into the smart contract and details.
Of course. And is it fair to say that in the end, we need to converge, let's talk about DeFi, right? We need to converge to a point where the end user gets the best price at the most possible size, and they won't really care how the underlying solution works as long as it works. Is that fair to say?
I mean, I think it is, right? If you ask all these DeFi people, you know, ask them, hey, why did you get into DeFi in the first place? Probably one of the main reasons or popular ones would be, hey, I want to make money. Or number two is if you're a nerd, okay, I think DeFi is cool, I'm playing around. But at the end of the day, it comes down to making money, right?
Yeah.
And if people do whatever they can to make the most money with less risk.
Exactly. Exactly. So price sensitivity and, like you said, liquidity. You know, one of the funny, or like not funny, but one of the things that we've observed in the previous cycle, right? You have these groups of people who become sort of cult members of a specific product. And that happens more during the bull cycle because, you know, you have some sort of tie, whether it's, you know, an investment or whether it's you just like the product or you just like the vibes or whatever. And, you know, as the market matures, our sort of expectation is, you know, the best price ultimately will win. And then, you know, you'll still have fans of specific products, but ultimately, you know, you have to evolve your product to give people the best end result that they're looking for. And majority of the people are just going to look at the price and ability to execute it quickly and cheaply.
Right.
Yeah. So what about trends, right? Like, what are the biggest trends? So you mentioned gaming, but what are the biggest trend that's driving Web3 today?
Yeah. The thing is, even today, right, I think about it when I'm in the shower and like, what is it? There really is no clear trend. Because a lot of times, like, we're still stuck on these very primitive, you know, user experience problems of trying to get people into space. Because I hear a lot of people saying, you know, oh, my competitor is so-and-so, or like this chain and that chain. I was like, no, your real competitor is trying to convert Web2 people into your, you know, Web3 platform in the first place. So I think we're thinking too small, right, in that sense. But I think in terms of what's coming forward, yeah, any infrastructure type projects that are going to support, you know, these hundreds and thousands of DeFi projects, gaming is going to be super critical, right? So like we were talking about liquidity, ones that can really optimize this can save hundreds and dollars of fees in a very big scale. Whereas, you know, one dApp trying to optimize it all on themselves just for their chain. So I'm not trying to shill or anything, but I actually do use it myself, and I think it's very good innovation, like Stargate, where it's like true native asset bridging. It's much, much better than these token wrapped type of cross chain. And I think this can really impact the next generation of DeFi and apps coming forward.
Absolutely. Agreed. Now, you touched on something, you know, in this answer as well as some of the other answers, right? It requires, you know, given where the UX is today, people need to learn about the different steps that they have to sort of go through. Obviously, you guys at the Human and the Machine, you're focusing on really simplifying what a given project or a product is about. And like, what is your advice to projects out there in terms of educating people, right? Like, again, you know, Dexalot is quite blessed. We have an amazing community who actually follow us. People are writing threads about us. People are writing medium articles about us. But it takes a certain amount of education to get people to understand what the product is about, etc. And like, what are some tips and tricks that you can give people, given that you guys are an expert in doing this? What are the things that you would recommend projects do as they're building their product?
Yeah, I'm so glad you asked this, right? Because I asked the same thing in projects. And the culmination of, let's say, responses I get, and based on my learning as well, don't try to conquer the world. Okay, I know you're a DeFi app, you're going to be international, right? It's open to everyone, that's great. But there's no way you can target every single country in the world and try to get users, right? So that's why I think when you're building your products, really think about who is your end user, right? Are they, you know, US citizens that have a much higher income and are able to spend, or, you know, English native, right? Or are you trying to target, let's say, people in Southeast Asia where they speak a very local language, and even things like an English seed phrase, you know, doesn't make sense to them, right? Because if it's not your local language, you know, how are you going to remember them in the first place? You know, you might even make a typo, right? And that's normal because that's not their first language. So I think being very conscious of who your users are, what are the demographics, and what are the types of behaviors. For example, like in certain countries, right, the internet speed may not be as fast. So you got to think about latency and how that would affect their user experience. So you can't just assume, you know, everyone has fiber optic speed like you would in, you know, certain countries. So I think having a very clear go-to market and building your initial product around that is super critical.
That's awesome. That's huge. I want to jump in real quick, guys, in the chat. If you do have any questions for Hikaru, please just type them in the chat and we'll get to them as they come. But yeah, that's a really good point, man. That's like, that's pretty huge, guys. I hope you're paying attention.
I mean, the one way I've always thought about this is find a niche first, right? And do that, whatever that may be, really well, right? Absolutely. Create something specific that solves a problem for an end user, you know, whether it's the best price or whether it's the most casual game that people can play. Try to find that niche that actually has a specific group and then try to expand from that. And that also allows projects to sort of get their message out in a more coherent and modular way. And you show people one thing. Once you understand that that one thing is well understood, then you expand it and you go to the next one, etc.
You kind of just described my DJ career a little bit. You know what I mean? Like that's, I started as a niche person and I, you know, in a former life, of course, but I mean, that's true in many industries, man. You know what I mean? You find your niche, you expand from there, and then you're throwing small parties, and next thing you know, you're selling out 3,000 cap venues. You know what I mean? So,
and this approach allows you to make mistakes as well, right? You can make a mistake when you're small, like when you're DJing, you know, for like 10 people. You can really be free, try things, and you can actually see what works, what doesn't work. And then you collect some data there, you expand, you collect more, you expand, collect more. I guess the underlying message here is you got to measure and track as you make decisions, and then impact is what basically gives you direction, right? Amazing. Yeah. What were you going to say something?
Yeah, it's kind of like, let's solve problems that are actually problems and not what you think are problems. Build the products and validate them, right, with your initial set of users. And I think that's way, way more important than just trying to build something fun and, you know, let it out there and see what happens, right? A lot of projects have died that way.
Yes, of course. So, okay, that gives me another opening. What is one specific problem that you think really needs a solution? I know that, you know, UX is a much larger one. Can you think of any concrete things that you have thought about and said, I wish somebody had solved this? Or is there a project that you and your partners have already sort of spent time with or interested that are solving an amazing problem? Would be great to hear some of those examples.
Yeah. I guess this comes down to technical limitation, the way smart contracts are. And the thing is, you know, I like decentralization, right? Being in control. But at the same time, it just really, really gets annoying. Clicking like minimum 2 to 3 times on MetaMask, you know, clicking enable each time I need to make a swap because I don't want to do like infinite spending. So if we can somehow shorten these, you know, clicks or taps, man, that would save a lot of time, right? And also frustration just with the everyday crypto activity.
So it's really for example, a wallet or gateway improvement that allows a user to reduce the time to the transaction without compromising on safety. If you obviously...
It's like I have this mixed feeling. It's like every time I see these MetaMask pop up, I'm like, okay, I know I'm in control, right? I know nothing's bad's going to happen at worst. But at the same time, it's like, right? You know, late night, 12 a.m., I got to keep pressing these, you know, wait for the transaction to go through.
Yeah.
Somehow it can be solved with, you know, less clicks. I think this can encourage a lot more people to come in.
And it obviously gets a lot worse when you're on a blockchain that does not finalize quickly. You know, you have to wait for the, you know, 10-minute and at times 60-minute confirmation so that the next transaction triggers and you're getting your pseudo guaranteed to be able to submit the next transaction, etc. Okay, guys, you heard it here first. Hikaru just dropped the alpha. Oh, we have a question, I think. One thing, okay, this is from Beast Lorian.
The beast.
One thing,
let's put it on screen. Hold on, I got you.
Yes, there we go.
Oh, that's nice. Wow, you guys got it figured out.
I want to be able to pay for stuff with crypto in real life, like pay for coffee with two a box. Bro, where do you live? Two Avox coffee?
That's like 2 seconds.
That's like,
seconds.
Ah, 2 seconds.
Damn good coffee.
Okay. All right. I was going to say, you know, Beastlorian, you know, drinks gold inclusive coffee. You know, like salt
bag. Yeah, like
delicious.
Yeah.
It sends you to the moon.
Yeah. And this is a fantastic comment, right? Like, imagine, dude, we talked about this earlier in the show. You swipe your credit card. You don't care what's happening under the covers. I am sure it's super cool. I am sure, whatever, at the time when that technology was conceived, it was, you know, mind-blowing. But I honestly don't care. I want to be able to pay for my coffee, make it go through fast. By the way, 2 seconds is probably faster than Visa or MasterCard confirmation when you put it in the POS, because I'm pretty sure that's like 4 or 5 seconds, right? So if we could finalize and pay for something in 2 seconds... and don't know what's happening under the covers, and it is Avalanche, great. If it's not, whatever. Like, I don't care. I just want to be able to do it, right? And that's when, I guess, you know, we could probably give financial advice and say, this market is definitely going to grow. So future potential for financial advice dropped here for the first time on In the Club. But I digress.
There it is, the beast. Bringing it, man. Thank you for the question. Hey guys, if you got any more questions, let us know. But Hikaru, I got a couple questions for you before we let you go, man.
I'll save mine for the end.
Oh yeah, okay. Well, yeah. Well, why don't you go first? Save you. What do you got?
Okay. Yeah. I mean, look, it's July, right? Officially, more than halfway into the year. You guys have been doing this for a long time. You know, you guys seen every little detail of the Dexalot journey. So, out of the many features, right, that came out this year, because you guys have made tremendous progress. And I know, Jimmy, you were talking about this new upcoming P&L as well. What's been the most absolute favorite feature or advancement of Dexalot that you guys see up until today? Or let's say for this year.
Yeah. Okay. So can I...
There's so many.
So let me answer it from a different few different perspectives.
Yeah, yeah.
Just one? You have to have one? You can't have more? I can look at it from
Firestorm is going to have like 7. So, I'll just say mine right off the top because I know Firestorm is going to have a bunch. I love the asset balance snapshot. I think that's super key for what we're doing. You know, when that got introduced, just the thing about that is that was built in. You know what I mean? It was baked into the subnet when it launched. And I just thought that kind of set us apart in a way that just would be really meaningful in terms of like having it right in front of you, being able to see everything, just in terms of giving you a centralized feel on the blockchain. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. That was the one that stuck out to me. And Firestorm, I know that was a big one for you too, but please, I know you got more than one, so go off.
I mean, it's very difficult to pick one because we built every single one of these features for specific segments of our community or for very specific and needed reasons. But I think there are two that really mattered the most. One is the Hummingbot integration. It's not exactly a feature, but it's a partnership which allowed our community to sort of come in and actually have a similar sort of capability as professional market makers that may otherwise just integrate it themselves. That's the supply side impact. I know that there's a few users who are very active in our community who are constantly giving us feedback about that, who are helping us launch more assets, et cetera. So it probably takes the prize. And the second one, which hasn't launched, so I can't compare it against the Hummingbot integration, is the atomic single transaction capability that we're about to launch. Right? We mentioned this multiple times. Now think of it this way. I have not been allowed to leak this yet, so I cannot show pictures, but we have been looking at the quality of our price and the quality of the liquidity, which I define as price at specific depth, right? What is the best price you can get for a certain amount of size? You know, other people out there will say, oh, we have the best TVL, bro. It's all about TVL. It's not true, right? It's only true about your end user getting the best possible price for the total size that they're actually trading, right? Now, we are basically looking at what Dexalot provides versus stuff out there. And the challenge that we've had so far is getting that best price and getting that depth to the users. We've had a sort of lack in access, which we're solving with this atomic transaction capability, as well as integrating that capability into the aggregators. So I think I don't want to talk super big or anything, but I think the most valuable feature for this year is going to be our ability to sort of give access to the general crypto community out there so that they realize where the best and most capital efficient pricing and liquidity is. So that's coming. Yeah. I know it's not a great answer because it's not yet here, but I think that's going to be the big one that really will sort of level us up.
Yeah, I mean, it's still...
Let me just chime in here, actually, because when I trade on a centralized exchange, right, okay, you see these ordered books, and then you kind of see, like, the bar and the depth. But, like, let's say I'm trying to make a trade, I'm manually taking out my calculator to see, okay, will my order get filled at this price? And it's really a guessing game, right? And if you could just show that in one, you know, snapshot, for this price, okay, you can fill 90% of your orders in no time, man, mm-hmm. you're going to make my life easier.
That's literally what we're going for. Look, one of the big... And this is going to your earlier point. One of the biggest innovations when Uniswap came around, it was twofold. One, they worked around the blockchain level problem of slow finality and expensive transaction fees. Instead of doing multiple transactions, they reduced it to a single transaction and they give a single click for people to trade. It's a massive user experience improvement. Traditional exchange sort of journey for the user is deposit, place orders, wait for fills, withdraw. That's many clicks. And I think it's important for a product like ours to provide the alternative as well, where you get a single click execution capability, right? And it still uses the capital efficient and best liquidity that we can generate for you without compromising on the UX. So that's how I sort of view this product. Again, the intention is to make your life easier. You actually gave me one more idea when you pulled out your calculator, because I pull out Excel, you pull out calculator, and I'm gonna tell this to the guys, see what we can do there. Maybe it's an additional feature, but absolutely, I think this is gonna be our top feature for the year, in my opinion, on the demand side.
I got an abacus, one of the, you know what I'm saying? I got one of those.
You're like clicking, you know.
Yeah, exactly. I'm just moving the things. It takes a lot of time, but you know, numbers are right. But what I was going to ask you before, man, is, you know what? I'm going to pre-answer. I'm going to say, you got to come back. You're coming back to the show. We got to have you back here again. Is that cool? That work for you?
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. How can I say no, man?
Yay. That's what I'm saying, man. Yeah. We love having you here, man. So you got to come back. Second question, I always do some music at the end of the show, at the tail end. So I got to get a song request from you. Doesn't have to be right now. If you want to dig through your Spotify or whatever and send it to our producer, you can do that. But if you got anything right now, I'll take it from you. We always play, do some DJing at the end of the show. So.
Okay. Lately, one song that I've been just listening over and over is Memories, you know, by Maroon 5. So.
Memories by who?
Maroon 5.
Oh, Maroon 5. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Awesome, man.
I'm not sure if it's a DJable, but
anything
is DJable, man.
That's the whole point. Yeah. Is I like to take in what our guests like and kind of reproduce it in a cool way on the turntables. You know what I mean? It's just kind of a fun thing that we do. Make things a little more fun around here. So we do like to have fun, but we also love to build, as you guys know. So Hikaru, this was great, man. We got to have you back on the show, but if there's not any more questions for Hikaru in the chat, we will let you go, man. But this has been amazing. We got to have you back, guys. Make sure you check out The Human and the Machine. If you like our show, you're going to love their show. Okay. So go check out their YouTube channel. Make sure you hit the subscribe button and ring the bell. I never get to say that because we're on Twitch. So
I'm pretty sure we did a show with The Human and the Machine.
We did.
With Luigi on there, with, I think, Genghis and Nihat on there. And we talked about Dexalot before the subnet, I want to say.
Yes.
Go check that out as well. See, like, it's funny. One of the things that I sometimes do is I go back to our very old recordings, see what we were saying back then, and see what we're doing now. And, like, there's tremendous progress along the way. Because
that's exactly the thing. Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
That's what I thought of the song Memories, right? Because we go a long ways back. Yeah.
Awesome, man. Awesome. I love that. Cool deal. Yeah. And, dude, there's just so much content on their channels. Just go check them out. This has been great. Hikaru, we got to have you back. Hikaru Kasai, everybody from The Human and the Machine chat. Thank our guy, Hikaru. Hikaru, thank you for being here, man. We will see you very soon, my friend.
Thanks, man. We'll see
you. Yeah. Thanks, Jimmy. Thanks, Firestorm, Dexalot, and the community. Yeah, really good to be here.
Appreciate you, man. We'll see you soon.